Hello and welcome to the second class from this series in which I'm going to tell you about responsive web design, how to plan responsive design workflow, how to talk to developers, what is a breakpoint, what is a viewport. After this class, you'll know all of it. This is a second class from this series. The first one was about typography, and if you missed that, just make sure you subscribe at DigitalDesigner.so. My name is Tom Biskup, and I'm a graphic designer and art director with almost 15 years of experience. And in my work, I focus on digital design mostly, including interaction design and animation design. You can check out my work at my Instagram page at tom.biskup. Check it out. And if you're ready to learn something new today, let's go. In today's world, websites are being browsed through a large variety of different devices and screen sizes. For example, the same website can be seen on a huge 30-inch 4K display, as well as on a tiny little narrow vertical mobile device screen. And responsive design is a process where we make sure that on both of these screens, experiencing the website will be similar and coherent. Here is the example of a well-made responsive design, and just to inspect it, I can grab the side of the browser window and then stretch it to be more narrow or wider. Pay attention to how content changes when we change the width of the browser window. The button and the pictures here get smaller and smaller the more narrow the window gets, and then there is text that gets smaller as well. And there are certain rules applied to all of the elements inside the layout, so the layout looks very coherent and almost the same on every resolution. Then there is a moment in this process where design breaks and changes to something completely different. So to understand all of this, we need to make sure we understand two terms that are associated with responsive web design. The first one is a viewport. The viewport is nothing more than just a window through which we look at the website. So it's nothing more than just an active part of the browser window in which we see the website. So it's the browser minus the system bar minus the address bar, and maybe if you have bookmarks here, minus the bookmarks. So this is the viewport. And understanding that there is a viewport and every user will look at your design through this viewport, and depending on which device will be used for browsing your design, the viewport will have different aspect ratio and different size. It's a very powerful concept that we can employ in day-to-day design. Because it really doesn't matter how your design looks in Figma if you design it. The user will always look at this design like this, through a tiny window. Just keep that idea at the back of your head that it doesn't matter how your design looks when you zoom out in Figma, it will be always viewed through this window of a viewport. Next thing we need to know is what is a breakpoint. So as you've seen before, the design adapts and stretches without any major changes in layout until I reach a point. For example, here is a point where something changes. The text size changes, the logo size changes, the button size changes, and the next one is here. And these points are called breakpoints. So breakpoint is a viewport with value measured in pixels where design changes. And if I see that this breakpoint happens here, I can now measure the window in pixels and see that there is a 768 pixels width right now. So I can be sure that the designer of this website decided that at 768 pixels, there is a breakpoint that will change the design, and the distribution of elements inside the layout will change at 768 pixels. So if the viewport has its width, and the width can be from 0 pixels to, let's say, 3000 pixels, although it can be more, but let's just simplify that a bit, then breakpoints are pixel values within this range that we, the designers, design as static images. For example, this is same design, designed for three different breakpoints, 1440, 1024, and 390. So it's a mobile breakpoint, a tablet breakpoint, and a desktop breakpoint. And if I hand over these designs to developers, they will come up with some clever tricks and rules for the content to scale between these resolutions, between these breakpoints. So just as you can see here, designer's job is to provide developers with certain breakpoints in the form of static designs. And then developer's job is to take care of the transitions between these breakpoints and setting rules for content stretching. There can be really a lot of different breakpoints, and you can see that in Figma when you try to create a new frame, you will get these presets on the right side of the screen. There are lots of different presets for different devices that are on the market right now. However, if we design one mobile breakpoint like 390, it will be good enough for the developers to come up with ideas how to transform this 390 pixel value to these similar values for different similar breakpoints. You can actually learn a lot about responsive design just looking at well-designed websites and checking them on different resolution, different viewport widths, and checking how they scale up and down by stretching the viewport. By doing that, you can reverse engineer all the decisions that had to be made for the site to stretch like this. First, I'm trying to find out how this website look on different sizes. To do that, I use a Google Chrome extensions called Windows Resizer. And here I can pick a size for my viewport. So if I want to see how it looks at 1440 width, it looks like that. And then to come up with some ideas of how the content inside the website should stretch, I just stretch the viewport width and look for breakpoints. No breakpoints here, but then when I come to this size here, so around 1200 pixels, there is a breakpoint saying that if the viewport becomes narrower than 1200 pixels, the content distribution on that website should change to two column view. As you can see here, the content was distributed in four columns, but when we hit 1200 pixels width, it becomes a two column layout. And then there is a third major breakpoint that changes the layout to one column layout. Just notice how the margins of the website changes. And this set of rules and breakpoints make this site work really, really well. There is a viewport width limit for certain browsers like Chrome, for example. I cannot see how this will look on a phone screen because it doesn't let me change the viewport to a narrower width than 500 pixels. So to emulate that, I will just enter DevTools, F12 on a keyboard, and then change the dimensions of the viewport to iPhone 12 Pro. Then change the size to 100%, and then I'm looking at the site being emulated on a phone screen. The most common practice while working with a dev studio is providing the dev studio with two different breakpoints, one for mobile, one for desktop. And when I was working with some really experienced studio, that was the case exactly. I was providing them with 1440 pixels breakpoint and 390 pixels breakpoint. And from then, it was developer's job to come up with all the missing breakpoints for tablets, for large desktops, and so on. Of course, this is a dream scenario for a designer, and sometimes Dev Studio won't be happy with just two breakpoints and they will ask you to design some more. Or you can be asked to design some additional breakpoints for certain pages inside your projects, or even for certain sections inside your pages, as developers might not be sure how to scale or stretch a certain design that you make inside a certain section. So what should change between different breakpoints? If we are talking about desktop versus mobile, the rules are pretty simple. In general, a good rule is to keep everything in one column on mobile resolution. There are exceptions to this, but if you are just starting, just make sure that all the content that you've designed is distributed vertically in one column, just like you see right here, and you'll be good. So if you're building your layout using a grid system of 12 columns, let's say, the rule is very simple. On a mobile resolution, you get only one column and distribute everything one after another in a vertical fashion. Things get really interesting when you are familiar with the auto layout tool, which is pretty amazing for changing rules for distribution of elements within layout. So as you can see here, I can really quickly adapt some components and sections to fit the new resolution, and by doing that I can clearly work with a set of rules and think like a developer while in Figma, which I really like. By using advanced Figma techniques, I can create something that looks like a coded website with breakpoints even. Just like here, you see a breakpoint where after reaching some widths of these components, they just change the way they are being distributed. So working with auto layout in Figma is definitely a way that I recommend working with. It's a great tool and it lets you think like a developer, setting rule to content distribution instead of just designing pretty pictures. If you are designing a mobile website and you're doing it on a desktop machine, just make sure that you preview your design constantly while designing on your mobile screen. And to do that, all you need to do is download Figma app for your iOS or Android device and then launch the mirror functionality inside this app and then select the frame that you want to mirror. Then tap begin mirroring and now I see my design. And I can check it out on my phone while I'm designing, which is the only proper way to judge if spacings, text sizes, and layout compositions are okay. So that's it for today's class. Hope you liked it. If you appreciate it, just let me know in the comments which tip you liked the most. My next class will be about basics of prototyping. So if you're into that, make sure you are subscribed at DigitalDesigner.so. We'll let you know about the future release of this class. And since you watch this, I assume that you're a creative. And let me remind you that I'm working on a full-scale web design course in which I will be taking you through the whole process of designing a website and explaining you the concepts like art direction, interface design, prototyping, just to name a few. So if you're into that, subscribe at DigitalDesigner.so and then we will let you know when the course launches. The course will be published by Design Practice and will have a large community around it, so I believe it might be a really cool thing. Okay, let's call it a day and see you in my next class about prototyping in a few days.